Summer greetings and welcome to the Asian American and Asian Research Institute's lecture series, online edition. I'm Anthony Wong, program coordinator of the Institute. Thank you to everyone for joining us on Friday morning or evening, depending on your time zone, for today's talk by editors Midori, Yamamura, and Yu-Chieh on their recently published book, Visual Representations of the Cold War and Postcolonial Struggles, Art in the East and Southeast Asia. This talk is co-organized with the Department of Visual Studies at Lingnan University in Hong Kong. Midori Yamamura is an assistant professor of art history at Kingsborough Community College, CUNY, and the author of Yayoi Kusama, Inventing the Singular. She is a specialist in post-World War II Asian and Asian diaspora art, and currently working on her second book, Japanese Contemporary Art Since 1989, Emergence of the Local in the Age of Globalization. Professor Yamamura has received fellowships from the Japan Society for the Promotion of Science, Mellon Foundation, Center for Place, Culture, and Politics at CUNY, and the Ford Foundation, among others. Yu-Chieh is a research assistant professor in the Department of Visual Studies, Lingnan University. She is a Judith Nelson postdoctoral fellow in contemporary art at UNSW Art and Design, Sydney, and an adjunct researcher at Tate Research Center, Asia. Professor Lee's research engages with aesthetics of performance, art in Asia, and socially engaged practices in curation resisting neoliberal globalization. Currently, she is working on a book project examining effect and the artistic autonomy of post-socialism. Please welcome Midori Yamamura and Yu-Chieh.
Hello, everyone. My name is Lee Yu-Chieh. I am a research assistant professor in the Department of Visual Studies at Lingnan University in Hong Kong. I am speaking today as a co-moderator together with Midori Yamamura, who will speak in a minute. We are very honored to have worked with 11 other authors on the book, Visual Representations of the Cold War and Postcolonial Struggles, Art in East and Southeast Asia. And we do want to thank the Routledge team and acknowledge support from City University of New York, University of New South Wales, and the Lingnan University. As you can see, Midori and myself have put the book discount code in the background, which you can also share with your peers. Just to explain the format of today's panel, Midori will briefly introduce the book structure and followed by four presentations and a roundtable plus Q&A. And as Anthony already mentioned, you're welcome to put your questions in the chat, which will be discussed during the Q&A. So before I hand it over to Midori, I'd like to explain briefly my view on the relation between the history of the Cold War in Asia and contemporary art historiography, which, as you know, is the major theme of the book. Although there is a growing number of English language literatures on Asian art and global art in recent decades, there is still a split between the discourses produced in the English-speaking academia and scholarly publications of other languages, such as the Chinese one. In the course of researching modernity, contemporaneity, and decoloniality in Asia, I often find myself torn between the critique against essentialism as a cultural symptom of post-colonial nation states and the strategic southernness, which I evoke from various scholars, including Ruth Simbao. So according to Ruth Simbao, strategic southernness is no fixed notion about knowledge from the South, nor global South. It seems to be a strategy of refusing to be tamed and instrumentalized under neoliberal globalization. We know discourses and theories are important, but it is difficult to generate them without enough art historical writing. In the cultural sites discussed in the book, modernity does not necessarily describe a breach from cultural heritage, and contemporaneity does not always overlap with decolonization. To grasp this kind of anachronism in Asian art historiography, one has to understand how the Cold War in Asia caused certain ideological divisions, the adoptions or absence of certain styles and thoughts, and the connections and disconnections among various sites. So for the book, we have brought together visual productions of different temporalities in the heterogeneous cultural zone that is labeled as Asia. And I embrace the fact that we are on the way of discovering more while admitting our failures and constraints. So now I'd like to invite Midori Yamamura to speak about the book.
Good morning and good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for attending to our talk this morning and this evening. In 2018, when Yu-Chieh and I began working on a book proposal for the Routledge's Cold War in Asia series, we both wanted to look at the Cold War from the South and wanted to think about its economic impact. Out of our research and discussions, what became apparent after the fall of the Soviet Union was the triumph of the United States as the last superpower, which is not a new concept. But within this new set of fault lines, the newly independent, politically unstable, and less economically developed countries, those emerged after World War II, became the subject of the more economically developed nations. And it came with a new moral code, which is the freedom to make inordinate gains without commensurable service to community, as historian Carl Polanyi observed in 1971. It's a type of freedom today known as neoliberalism. As the art historians, our goal became not to explore neoliberalism itself, but the artistic responses to the situations that created by neoliberalism. We could have shaped the book in many different ways, but eventually we agreed to look at East and Southeast Asia, especially the Pacific Island chains where the US presence was and is still prominent for defense purposes. To these, we added Australia, because in the 1990s, Australia became an important hub of Asian art. In the book, Russell Storr contributed an important new research on Australian exhibition history, considering that art can make people's collective perception visible, which he considers is, quote, an important means of understanding a national psyche in retrospect, unquote. With the Korean War currently in a state of armistice and Okinawans facing the controversial relocation of the US base, and with China being the world's second largest economy, emerging as a new threat to the United States, the Cold War in Asia is nowhere close to ending. Thus, we conceived the Cold War as continuous. The three sections of this book are: Part one, joining the game, trauma and regionalism. Part two, visual gallery and primary documents. Part three, the continuous Cold War. Part one and three are scholarly writings, which are bridged by the artistic works and primary sources by the artists. The contributing scholars are Lesley Ma, Roger Nelson, who are here today, Ulan, the Gandro, Russell Storr, Yu-Chieh Lee, Rebecca Jennison, Jun-Jun Lee, and myself. The artistic section includes Hiroshi Sunairi, FX Harusono, Dean Q. Lee, Oso Yi, and Kao Jun-Hon. And in this structure, we are hoping that the book is going to stimulate a reflection rather than pushing particular answers. So thank you very much, and I hope you will enjoy today's talk.
Thank you very much, Midori. So I'd like to start introducing the first speaker, Lesley Ma. Lesley Ma is curator of ink art at M+, which is a museum of visual culture in Hong Kong, opening in late 2021. And since 2013, she has led the museum's acquisition and programming on ink art and is on the core planning team of the opening exhibitions and publications. Lesley curated exhibitions such as The Weight of Lightness, Ink Art at M+ in 2017, and also co-curated the Parasite exhibition Great Crescent, Art and Agitation in the 1960s, Japan, South Korea, and Taiwan. She was project director at Taekwondo Studio in New York and curatorial coordinator at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Los Angeles. Lesley holds a PhD in art history, theory, and criticism from the University of California, San Diego. So without further ado, let's welcome Lesley to the podium.
Good evening and good morning, everyone. My name is Lesley Ma. I'm curator of ink art at M Plus in Hong Kong. First, this is my pleasure to be here today with all the prestigious speakers and all the audience members. But I would like to first thank Yu-Chieh and Midori for inviting me to contribute to this meaningful anthology. So I will begin with a synopsis of the paper and then go into details about the methodology, context, and the artworks. So the title of my talk and my paper today, The New Chinese Landscape in the Cold War Era, this paper, in fact, is a modified from my 2016 dissertation chapter. The New Chinese Landscape, six contemporary Chinese artists, marked a watershed moment when modernist ink paintings produced outside of mainland China became a representative of a post-war Chinese cultural identity. Sponsored by the John D. Rockefeller Third Fund, the precursor to today's Asian Cultural Council, and organized by art historian Zhu Jingli, this exhibition toured the US from 1966 to 1968 with paintings that synthesized ideas from classical Chinese landscape paintings and mid-century American abstraction made by Chinese artists in Taiwan, including three from the Fifth Moon Painting Society and the US. This paper details the stylistic and geographical shift in Chinese art by investigating the impact of Cold War geopolitics on aesthetic choices, curatorial framework, and viewer expectations. Close readings of the works contextualize them within the history of Chinese landscape painting and the international trends of abstract art, revealing the political meanings of the new landscape. The study illuminates how the internationalization of ink painting, steered by the Chinese diaspora, determined the course of post-war Chinese art. So this exhibition that I'm focusing on is in fact the first exhibition of Chinese painting to be presented in the post-war Western world. So I'm using this exhibition, this methodology is using the exhibition as a seminal force that shaped the development of ink art and post-war Chinese art. And through this exhibition, we can see how the forces of Cold War geopolitics impacted the course of our history, and by looking at the exhibition curation and circulation, as well as how the artworks fit into this framework. So just a few things about the exhibition basics. Here you see the exhibition toured in the US from 1966 to 68, and this was on the screen, you see almost the last leg of this show at the Cleveland Museum of Art. This show included six artists, all were born in mainland China, but left around 1948, 49, very important years in Chinese history. The exhibition included 60 works, about 10 works each of each artist, and I went to 15 institutions across the US, including New York and many Midwestern big cities and their university art galleries. The main subject of the exhibition, obviously, is Chinese landscape painting. And why was it Chinese landscape? So you see the curator, Zhu Jingli, here at the time was a Chinese art historian at the University of Iowa. And he was among the earliest earliest art historians of Chinese art that formulated Chinese art as an academic study in the US. So he already played an instrumental role in starting that discipline. Of course, our historians at the time studied classical art. So he went to Taiwan in 1964 with other Chinese art historians to look at the National Palace Museum's collection in Taiwan. And on this trip, he identified the artists that he wanted to put together in this exhibition. In a way, he saw them as the hope of Chinese painting. And he had identified landscape as a main theme, not only because the artists were using that, but he knew that as a Chinese art historian, landscape is the highest form of Chinese painting. It was the most distinguished, highest form of literati culture. And also most distinguished internationally as a representation of Chinese art. And as he cites Chinese landscape history, landscape painting since the 10th century have become a surrogate for many things. It could be a natural in all of the nature. It could be the educated scholar's moral aspiration. It could be political refuge, emotional dwelling, as well as just singing praises for the celebrations of the magnificent landscape. So this genre of painting has already acquired many kinds of interpretations throughout the centuries. And this is something to remember for our discussion. So next, I would like to introduce a little bit about the political and artistic context in Taiwan at the time. And as I mentioned earlier, many US-based art historians went to Taiwan to look at treasures from the imperial collection that was brought to Taiwan by the nationalists after 1949. And this is sort of the key and why this article would be in this book. 1949 is the watershed moment when the nationalist government was defeated in the Chinese Civil War and retreated to Taiwan. This split not only is historical or personal for many people, but also is split the art development in these places between China, between mainland China and Taiwan. But as Taiwan sits on the very strategic zone on the Pacific Rim, it is the only China, the free China, recognized by the international world and part of that, the free China in the Western democracy kind of understanding. The country needed to establish itself not only politically, but also culturally. And these Orthodox Chinese paintings from centuries ago thus became the cultural asset and also diplomatic tool for the nationalist government in Taiwan. But at the same time, they were these sort of pillars of Chinese culture for artists living in Taiwan at the time, as they dealt with the idea of displacement and frustration having to move to Taiwan. Many of them were already established or as teenagers losing that connection to the motherland. But at the same time, a lot of these mainland born artists moved to Taiwan were already educated as artists since the dynastic time. Here you see two examples of artists representing more or less these mainland ink painters who were continuing their styles that they had back in China. Here are Pu Xingyu and Huang Junbi, the top two paintings on the right. And these are the styles that were quite dominant in academies for training in Chinese ink painting in Taiwan at the time. But at the same time, Taiwan was under Japanese Japanese colony for 50 years prior to 1945. So you have Taiwanese-born artists who were trained under the Japanese art system, painting Western-style oil paintings. And here you see two examples of artists. One is more figurative; the other one going after this fauvist style in Taiwan. So you can see that in Taiwan, this is a very complex cultural contact zone and in this post-war decade. And the artists that I'm going to talk about and also talked about in this paper had to deal with these kind of complex powers and forces within their visual vista. So the first three artists in this group, in this exhibition, were part of this modernist art group called Fifth Moon Society. And on the top right, you see one of their annual exhibitions in Taiwan in the 60s. This group began in the late 50s and were active all today. These artists are still working today. But at the time in Taiwan, they were trying to carve out a new space for their painting. As you can see in the previous slide, all these different styles were there for their reference, but also as the departure point for their own voice. So at the time also, they wanted to make sure their paintings not only follow a certain glorious idea of Chinese culture, but also have to reflect their psychological and emotional reality as well as the country's reality. So in a way, they're negotiating between that cultural heritage and their personal experiences. At the same time, as both Midori and Yu-Chieh had alluded to, American forces, especially cultural forces, were especially strong in the Pacific at this time. The influx of information about American abstract expressionism has, of course, reached these artists' radar. So they also wanted to become artists that are that make works that are readable on the international stage. So with all these forces together, they decided that a kind of synthesis between ideas from classical landscape painting and calligraphy and this kind of American expressive abstraction is something they want to push forward to. And in the way here, you see their works represented by Liu Guosong, Zhuang Zhe, and Feng Zhongrui. Their works try to import new techniques, abandon traditional tools, so no longer using the Chinese brush, oftentimes even abandoning just using ink, but also using paper collage, adding surface texture. But at the same time, even though they abandon some of these basic materials, but they draw attention to this kind of visual signifier of landscape painting. One cannot help but notice that both Liu Guosong and Zhuang Zhe's work sort of alluded to the paintings on the left. You see that monumental landscape style, but nothing they did was replicating the traditional methods and the way of depicting these kind of landscapes. So the other three artists in this exhibition that Zhu Jingli had identified had a little bit different background. Yu Chengyao on the far left is a self-taught artist, and he was born in 1898, so the most senior of this group. He was not part of this artist group because he was self-taught, but almost under the radar, working on his own as a retired general from the Nationalist Army. And his landscape is somewhat more traditional in format and style, because this is a hanging scroll, but none of the ways that he painted them have followed anything related to traditional texture strokes. And on the right side, you have two artists who have spent their time in New York. Chen Qiquan on the top right was trained under Walter Gropius. So modernist architecture is his specialty. He's a modernist architect, but he also painted using technology, namely photography. He uses panoramic photography as a way to describe, import this kind of shifting perspectives in Chinese landscape painting into his work. C.C. Wang on the bottom right was a longtime New York fixture. He was a connoisseur and was traditionally trained. And he was living in New York since 1948. And the heyday of abstract expressionism did made him add more texture to his painting. So in the way, these three artists are sort of an outlier of this whole group. I think the curator picked the two artists from New York, perhaps because they were already US-based and had exposure in commercial galleries in the US specializing in Chinese art. And Yu Chengyao is someone, I think the US at the time really favored stories of these Grandma Moses, self-taught artists who achieved certain artistic success. So interestingly, these artists is why the show was called the New Landscape. You can see that the type of landscape painting is different. It had new techniques, new approaches, and imaginations. Landscape historical function as artist genre was repeated. In a way, they were describing artist frustration because these artists are all displaced from mainland China and had to live elsewhere, could not return. But also with these artists, centered in this exhibition, Taiwan used to be a peripheral island in Chinese history, and our history is now forefront and center and playing an important role in this whole new construct of what post-war Chinese art is. And at the same time, roping in these artists who were living in New York, the larger Chinese diaspora now becomes more important in the whole construct of Chinese art. So back to the first slide of this exhibition. Interestingly, this show was not well reviewed in the US, even though it had very strong support from the Rockefeller Foundation, as well as managed by the American Federation of the Arts, an organization that's still functioning today for touring exhibitions. The exhibition reviews were mostly talking about the sort of traditional versus contemporary, or identifying these paintings as in a mountain on scrolls, are typically Chinese, but nobody really looked deeply into why they were significant and why they were continuations of a traditional Chinese aesthetics. I think partially the way that they're displayed hindered their reception. You see on the far left, many paintings were installed behind these very classically designed vitrines for classical paintings. And also the museums that were receptive to this exhibition to as part of the touring spots are museums that already have a classical collection of Chinese art in order to make that connection. So all in all, even though it wasn't so smartly reviewed, this exhibition did validate this direction for the artists included in this exhibition, especially the Fifth Moon group. These artists who had never been abroad, never shown abroad in this such curatorially driven exhibition, were given sort of a boost in confidence of their direction. And these artists today were still working sort of along these lines. And in that sense, even though the exhibition wasn't well received in the US, the internationalization of the ink painting under this Cold War geopolitics really validated the direction for these artists and determine this direction for Chinese painting. And I have to say that my own position at M Plus today as a curator of ink art really is hugely indebted to this kind of construct as the way that it had pushed Chinese painting into this more internationalized view. And so I was able to study these artists and also think about how that fits into the larger global history of visual culture. So thank you very much. And I welcome your questions at the end.
Thank you very much, Lesley. That was a very fascinating summary, and we do look forward to seeing it published into a monograph in the future. And I'd like to now introduce the second speaker, Roger Nelson. Roger Nelson is an art historian and curator at National Gallery Singapore. He is author of the book, Modern Art of Southeast Asia, Introductions from A to Z, and translator of Suong Soring's 1961 Khmer novel entitled A New Sun Rises Over the Old Land. Roger is co-founding co-editor of Southeast of Now, Directions in Contemporary and Modern Art in Asia, a journal published by NUS Press. He completed his PhD at the University of Melbourne, specializing in Cambodian arts of the 20th and 21st centuries. He has contributed to scholarly journals and art magazines and has curated exhibitions in many countries, including Cambodia, Singapore, Thailand, and Vietnam. A recent curation is entitled "And in the Chapel and in the Temples, Research in Progress by Buddhist Archive of Photography and Amy Lian and Enzo Camacho." So I'd like to invite Roger to speak now.
Thank you so much for the lovely invitation and introduction. And good evening and good morning, everyone. But it's a real pleasure to be here. And I must say as well, I really look forward to laying hands on the book. So my chapter in this book asks whether images really always offer insights into the context from which they emerge, and also whether this is always the most sensitive or generative way to approach the art and visual culture that emerges from Southeast Asia in the Cold War era. But I'm going to leave those questions aside for today. And instead of giving you a summary of the chapter, I want to just briefly introduce the two corpuses of images that the chapter deals with, which in different ways depict the so-called secret war that was waged by the United States in Laos as part of the Second Indochina War from 1959 until 1975, and was never, of course, a secret for those in Laos. So the first body of images is a group of 28 photographs depicting victims of American bombing and related scenes, which were collected by a senior Buddhist abbot in Luang Prabang in Laos, named Pa Kampan Sila Sangwara, who was also a celebrated maker and collector of photographs. The second body of image is a series of paintings depicting Air America planes that were deployed under the order of the US CIA for clandestine military and other purposes in Laos. These were painted by Terry Wofford, formerly Terry Gilbert, a British-born self-described aviation artist who lived and worked in Vientiane in Laos from 1968 until 1972, while her American husband was a pilot for Air America. So in the chapter, I argue that these two bodies of images need to be studied not only in relation to their Cold War context in Southeast Asia, but also with reference to practices that historically predate the conflict in Laos and also that geographically extend beyond the region. But as I said, I'm going to leave that aside for today and instead just read a little excerpt from the chapter to try and zoom in on some of the images themselves, because really my method has been has really begun and tried to stay with the images themselves. So here goes. The first image, a photograph not titled, printed in silver gelatin on inexpensive paper, dated circa 1960s. In this image, a young child tilts its head back, resting on the cheek and shoulder of a young woman, perhaps the child's mother. The skin on the child's face is discolored and blistered. It appears to have been burned, either by flames or by chemicals, or perhaps by both. The child's mouth is open, as if in the uneasy sleep of unconsciousness, yet not open enough to be crying. The corners of the child's full, soft-looking lips are turned slightly downwards, as if in pain or perhaps in many kinds of pains which cannot be conveyed in a cry. The child's eyes are closed, and the slight but perceptible tightening of its brow above them suggests that the eyes are closed tightly as if to shut out the world. The woman's eyes are averted from the photographer's lens and thus from our gaze. She's looking down to the child. Her brow, too, furrowed into a frown, an knitted expression of care and concern, again, seemingly silently. The entire image, captured in black and white, closely framed around the two faces, yet in the blurred shapes in the background, visible at the top right corner, we might imagine to be the lush tropical foliage of a Laotian jungle, with its sounds of fertile life and also of lethal violence. On the reverse of the image, a typewritten caption in the Lao language asserts that, quote, the disaster of the war brings sadness for life and nation. By activating both sides of the photographic print, the maker or makers of this inexpensively produced image transform what the photography conservator and scholar Paul Messier terms a functional photography paper into an expressive paper, and thus simultaneously signal both the objective reality and also the interpretive subjectivity in not only this image itself, but in the entire photographic print as a double-sided object. But who is this child in this image? Who is this woman? What specific disaster of the war has befallen them? Are they victims of the covert aerial bombing in which, terrifyingly and deafeningly, one bomb was detonated on average every 8 minutes for an entire decade? Or are they casualties of ground battle in which proxy soldiers were known to have indulged in extreme brutality encouraged by their American backers, such as, most infamously, the severing of the ears of their victims? Are this woman and child only victims, or what might we imagine them to also be perpetrators of violence? Have they posed for this image, or have they been caught unawares in a candid moment by the photographer? Did this woman and this child live, or did they die? Was the child perhaps, do we dare to imagine, already dead when this photograph was taken? These are some among any number of questions that I think the photograph provokes. So too do the other photographs among the 28 collected by the senior Buddhist abbot, Pakamphan Silasangwara, that relate specifically to this secret war. These are questions that remain unanswered and will remain unanswerable. These photographs were made by unknown photographer or photographers, likely closely involved with the communist organization known as the Puppet Lao, were collected by Pakamphan, presented to him after his visit to the communist-controlled liberated zone and kept in his kuti or abode within the Wat Suwanakili temple and monastery in Luang Prabang. The photographs were discovered there in 2007, 2 decades after Pakamphan's death, by researchers working for the then newly established Buddhist Archive of Photography, which is housed in the grounds of the same temple and which has really sort of formed the central core of my research on the visual representations of the secret war in Laos. But now let's turn to a second image, a painting titled Dropping Supplies, done in oil on canvas in a palette of saccharinely cheerful pastel tones, dated 1971. The painting's sun-drenched colors recall the family-friendly Technicolor movies made by Disney or Paramount during the 1960s and 70s. This is the palette of an all-American fantasy world very far from the horrors of the war in Laos. Filling the frame, extending to all four sides of the portrait-oriented picture, is the pale cerulean blue and pristine chalky white of a lightly clouded sky. This is not a realistic depiction, of course, it is a fantasy. The artist has carefully framed the imagined composition to give the impression of looking upwards. There is no horizon line, no visible land, just endless sky and the airborne objects that are the painting's real subject filling the picture plane. These are wooden crates, suspended from parachutes and falling towards the unseen earth below, as well as a small aircraft flying away from the scene, which has evidently dropped these crates and is now making its swift exit. The crates' hefty construction with double reinforcements on each side suggests that they are large and holding a substantial cargo. They are suspended from parachutes which have ballooned to their maximum inflation. The painting is imbued with a still and calmly quiet air, an almost childlike sense of peace and wonder. Yet defying this cheery mood of almost cartoonish calm is the fact that the aircraft flying away from the crates on the painting's left is in fact a warplane. More specifically, it is identified by the artist as a Fairchild C-123K, an American military plane used throughout the Second Indochina War, which is described by the National Museum of the US Air Force as, and I quote, a short-range assault transport used for airlifting troops and cargo from small, unprepared airstrips, and I quote again, an essential part of the US Air Force airlift during the Southeast Asia War, and also the type of plane that was used often for the spraying of Agent Orange. This was one of the Air America fleet of planes that was flown by Bob Wofford, an Air America pilot who the artist at the time named Terry Gilbert would marry the following year after making this painting. The crates depicted here are filled with arms and ammunition, which the Air America pilots and their crowd called hard rice, to distinguish it from the actual edible rice, which they sometimes called soft rice, which was also sometimes airlifted into remote areas of Laos, dropped from planes, the sacks often bursting upon impact. According to the published History of Air America, military activities in Laos intensified in the years between 1968 and 1973, meaning that, and I quote, Air America had to transport more troops, more hard rice, and more big guns than before, and more company aircraft were shot at or even shot down. This period of intensified aerial warfare, which also saw an explosion in the number of refugees fleeing the bombing in Laos, corresponds precisely with the period in which Terry Wofford lived and worked in Vientiane. Yet no sense of that violence and danger is conveyed in the cheerful colors, quiet tones, and placid atmosphere in this painting, Dropping Supplies. And the artist herself has explained that she believes Air America as having been, and I quote, performing a service that was primarily humanitarian and in exceptionally dangerous service circumstances, and that the majority of Air America missions were delivering aid of all sorts. This optimistic conviction is belied in many other paintings made at the time, such as this one titled Night Mission Over Laos, which depicts an Air America spy plane flying a night reconnaissance mission over a rural Laotian village. Quite at odds with the earlier work, the palette in this work is dark and ominous. The plane depicted here, the artist explains, is, and I quote, a highly modified electronic fueled spy plane that flew night patrols and also stayed aloft during the day for many hours. The aircraft's operation was unaffected by cloud cover, according to the artists, yet the clouds in her depiction of its work are, and I quote, symbolic of the hidden nature of these missions. The pitched roof houses of the Laotian village visible in the ground below all have lights burning inside. The careful inclusion of this detail leaves us wondering, as the spy plane's operators must have been, what is happening in this village, what is being said or planned or done. With retrospective knowledge of the scale of the destruction during the secret war in Laos, we might also wonder, did this village survive or was it bombed into oblivion by another American plane? The sense of danger and mystery in this painting leaves us guessing and fearful. And I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Roger. I think that was a fascinating juxtaposition and visual analysis. I think Midori will introduce the other speakers now.
Okay, The next speaker is Hiroshi Sunairi. Originally from Hiroshima, Hiroshi is known for tree project, which asks people to raise the tree seeds from atom bomb trees. Today, he will speak about his latest documentary film from the three-part film on Okinawa, which is entitled OK2, From Okinawa with Love. He will be speaking about Mao Ishikawa, the photographer Mao Ishikawa and her photo books. Please welcome Hiroshi.
Thank you, Midori, for introduction, and thank you everyone for being here. And thank you for the opportunity. And I'm just sharing this image and I'm gonna start talking. This image is from, this is the cover of the of a book called Red Flower, The Women of Okinawa by Mao Ishikawa, who's a Okinawan female photographer. And I met Mao when she came to exhibit her pictures of the US bases in Okinawa in a group exhibition, The Perpetual Moment, Visions from Within Okinawa and Korea, at MoMA PS1 in 2004. Then later in 2016, I saw her again in New York. This is the republishing of the Akabana book at the Dashwood Books of Noho. And Akabana, The Women of Okinawa, is about Okinawa photographer Mao Ishikawa during her early 20s, between 1975 to 1977, worked as a barmaid in establishments catered to African-American GIs stationed in Koza City and Kingtown, Okinawa. At the time, Black soldiers still faced considerable discrimination in the US and the military. And Okinawa women like Ishikawa, who had relationship with these Black men, were derided as pampan, prostitutes. Ishikawa produced body of photographs that documented diuristic intimacy of friendship, love affair, wild nights, and domestic accords shared amongst her social circle. And briefly after her republishing party at the Dashwood Books, she had a lecture at the East Asian Department of NYU. The symposium was titled as Looking at Okinawa, Race, Gender, Nation. The first speaker showed Mao's photograph as the very image of the struggle of Okinawan women. We noticed Mao with her head down, and we got worried as we knew, me and my friends knew that Mao had a cancer, which she just found out earlier that year. After the first lecture, Mao came on stage as a second lecturer. She was furious about her picture being used without permission, as well as being politicized. She stormed about her pictures being not about politics or struggle, but love. She then went on about how she began this project, taking pictures of these women, along with Black soldiers, Black American soldiers. She grew up in Okinawa, an island that was occupied by the US after the World War II, learning, hearing, and seeing often news about rapes and murders of Okinawa women and men by the US military personnel. From 1945 to 1972, Ryukyu police, the Okinawan police, had no right to detain US military members, and basically Americans did whatever they wanted. So many rapes and murders unreported and swept under the rug. When Okinawa was returned to Japan in 1972 from the US, and when Okinawa people realized that they came back to Japan with the US military bases attached, they went on a rampage. She was there in a demonstration as a high school student. As Mao said, "I've been thinking since then, what is Okinawa to Japan?" For her, an authentic Okinawa was the US military in Okinawa, because that's what she grew up with. She wanted to photograph Okinawa, so American soldiers became her interest. And that's how she jumped into working at a bar that served Black GIs in Koza. In 1970s, right after the civil rights movement in the US, US soldiers, soldiers' entertainment joints in Okinawa were still segregated to the white area and the Black area. She began working at the one of the Black bars as a barmaid, not knowing English, the first time meeting a Black person. She knew nothing about them, and she couldn't tell from one person to the other. They all looked the same to her. She began taking pictures of Black folks as she met at the bar, the girls she worked with, some Okinawan girls, some Japanese girls, her and her sexual intimacy, some life, as she said in the film, letting it all out, semen, sweat, spit, banging each other. The rawness was real. Let me share that rawness. As Mao has gone through some relationship with Black soldiers, she starts to understand some good, some trouble, some lied about being single while having a wife and kids back in the US. She learned them as an individual, as warm as every one of us, as flaky, as proud, as sneaky, as genuine, depending on that individual. She no longer saw them as Black people. She knew him as a person with complexity and contradiction, as we all are. She also became fascinated with women at the bars, despite how Okinawa people disregarded these girls mingling with Americans and the Black people. These women did what they wanted. This freedom she found thrilling, amazing, and liberating. And this is what she says in the film, doing what you love, saying what you want, naked because it's hot. Why is that bad? It's a freedom on this tiny island to do it with confidence. It's nice to live like that. People should let themselves free. Am I right? For her, the images of these women are the very images of their freedom. Not struggle, not politics, but love of their livelihood. Hearing her talk in the context of US, because I live in US, with the social media filled with the police brutality towards African-American people, then the Black Lives Matter later. So Mao's straight talk intertwined with her own racism, coming to understand Black people through experience, moved me so much. So straightforward. And as I am in the context of ultra-sensitive racial politics in the US, I found her discourse fresh and effective. I thought American people should hear her talk. And that's how I became interested in making a documentary about her. Share the next one, the work is beautiful. Of course, because I knew about her stage 4 cancer, which also forced me to act fast to start a documentary. And what is her resolution to capturing authentic Okinawa? That is the US military in Okinawa through her book. This is what she says. Okinawa families have family members married to Americans, or they have relatives working in the military, or those who accept American soldiers that are family members. However, they could be anti-Americans. So it's quite normal for two ideas to exist in one Okinawa person. And she says, back then, I met Okinawa soldiers myself. I fell in love, understood many things. I love US soldiers. I hate US military. This is her last quote. Anyhow, so in some ways, my film sort of reflects the mayhem of the people under the post-colonial and Cold War regime. And in some ways, it's a very lively mayhem. And if I have enough time, I would like to show the the trailer. Is it possible? Do I have two more minutes? Two minutes.
Yes, yes.
Great. So let me share that.
だから本当になんかまあ写真を眺めてみてなんか浮かんでくることを喋ってもいいんじゃないですかね。
うん、まあとにかくつれづれにこれのことは喋ってた？
その一枚のことは喋ってないと思います。
うん、分かった。じゃあ何喋ったか喋ってないか分からんけど、とにかくなんかエピソードが浮かんだら言うね。
はい、
でスタートって言って。
はい、もう撮ってますよ。
あ、本当。あのさ、そこには愛があったっていうのはこれは本屋さんがつけたタイトルなんだけど、本当にこれなんだよ。ラブ、愛。私がこの写真全体通して分かったのは、いろんな他の人はいろんなこと言うけれど、本当にこの街で。あの男を愛して女を愛した男と女がいた、それの物語なんだよこれは。私は毎日毎日カメラをあの肩にして毎日とにかく日記代わりに写真撮っていたから、でこの時もカメラを持っていたのでね、はいみんな撮るよってバチャって撮ったわけ。とにかく私はこの雰囲気が大好きで、それで表紙になってて、でそこに愛があったっていうタイトルがこれ気に入ってこの表紙はよ。The next speaker is Kidlat Tahimik, who is a Filipino independent filmmaker and a subject of my chapter, Chapter 4. The chapter is about an unforgettable summer that we spent with a recycled bombhead bell for peace, made of out of an unexploded bomb the US used to attack Japanese in Baguio, the Philippines during World War II. And Kidlat and the Baguio artist brought it to Hiroshima for healing our planet Earth. That was the art project name in 1995. Trained as an economist, Kidlat rejects the Hollywood style big budget production, embraces instead the cup of gasoline filmmaking method. It required 40 years for him to complete a single film, Balik Bayan 1, which I think translates as Return to Home Country Number 1, which is about Magellan's slave Enrique de Malacca's circumnavigation in 1521. In the film, Enrique manages his misfortune by going with its current. Ultimately, Magellan dies and Enrique survives. Today, I asked him if he can speak about what came after Enrique's journey. So please welcome Kidlat. Thank you.
I was trying to find how I could relate to this conference. When I started reading who were the speakers and what were their topics, I said, how can I mix with these people? And I asked Midori to try to give me a clue. In a way, I guess maybe the word Cold War already scared me, because what are my films and what are my processes? Are they have any relation at all to the Cold War? But maybe Midori gave me a little door, and I think it's okay that colonization, the old colonial drive of Magellan, and how maybe it's still nonstop going on today, and maybe how, as an artist, I try to deal with this topic. Maybe I can sneak in into your little door. Okay. If we're trying to understand how artists create a new language or new visuals or even processes of doing their art as a response to the situation where maybe the Cold War was like an umbrella and over. Maybe I can find my way. And in Philippines, we say, we do things kapa-kapa, you know, you kapa-kapa, you grope your way into the thing. And I think not like academics who spell out things very clearly before they even open their mouth. Let me start with my first film called Perfume Nightmare, which came out in 78. I got classified immediately by the intellectuals as, wow, this third cinema filmmaker. I thought, oh, yeah, maybe they're talking about the third world filmmaker born in a third world, telling a third world story. And yeah, making it a third world way. Of course, only maybe two decades later, I realized that third cinema is a very heavily loaded word with ideological nuances. And it was not as simple as just being a third world filmmaker and telling a third world story. So I wondered whether this is also an entry point. I realized from the films I've made and the reactions is that although my themes might have been consciously trying to talk about some third world issues or motifs, I think the way of making the film became something where well, the medium is the message. I mean, how I completed my first film, 16 millimeter, there was no video in those days, with the high cost of celluloid and everything, and how I somehow completed a story and reached the finish line. Maybe this was somehow emerging of the topic I was talking about and the process of making the film. So maybe my question was, is this what Midori meant, that maybe artists are innovating their processes or coping with new processes because of an overall theme that was being fought out in the Cold War? Maybe, yeah, Midori mentioned that I tore up my MBA diploma. So it shows that in a way I got caught in a way of thinking that is very predominant in America. Do things big, go with big budgets, make big profits, and maybe that would have led me to just become a Hollywood filmmaker or try to be one. No, but my films are made on almost zero budget, and somehow I asked myself, did tearing up my diploma, MBA diploma, just instead of, you know, way of burning the bridge, is that all it takes to decolonize a filmmaker? I mean, can I say, hey, I've done it. I've torn the diploma, which I think also Donald Trump has, I found out lately. Okay, but maybe I have to look back how I grew up. I have been colonized since I was a kid. I was born in an American hill station, and Americans came to the Philippines. They were very amateur colonialists, and they found out, oh, it's too hot to govern in Manila, so let's find a hill station. They found a hill station, and it's in the middle of a very rich indigenous culture. And so I had to grow up with this mix of indigenous wisdom from the tribals and this cosmopolitan culture from an American world power. Now, when I made Perfume Nightmare, my hero was somebody who was unconsciously fighting, if you can use that word, cultural imperialism. And by making the film, I guess I must have really debunked all my MBA knowledge from Wharton and did it, with all the just willpower to reach the finish line. BFI, British Film Institute critic, wrote, Perfume Nightmare, you end up watching this very crudely made film, and in the end, you're rooting for the filmmaker to reach the finish line, the end. And there was a South African critic who described Perfume Nightmares, it's like a shanty house where, you know, it's made of cardboard, bits of glass, bits of tin, but every single piece is so vital. So that made me look at my process and I say, hey, maybe that's how I got classified as third cinema, but I don't feel I have any ideological way of thinking that can relate to the way they do their things. And okay, that's where maybe in a way I had to think about it, because my mother, when she saw the film, was kind of confused and said, but she drew up something and she said, Kidlat, why did you make such an anti-American film? I guess, I'm not sure I was making something anti-American, but I had to think about it because my lovely mother is just, she's had to find a simple answer that I could say. And I think I made that film more about the circumstance of our local culture being suppressed or displaced by that strong American culture that dominates the country now. So maybe that's why I took an MBA. Anyway, that's another story. If that culture of America was such an important thing that now I might frame it as, but did it make a monster in me that I have to grapple with? So maybe in a way, I might think of it this way, that the process that I had made, I just got an old Bolex camera, hand wound. I used myself as the main actor. I mean, a lot of filmmakers do that now, but I bought expired film and just somehow over 2 years just pieced it together until it crossed the finish line. And I began to see in a way how, maybe when I first tried to make a movie, I thought, it might be like a Hollywood film. Not understanding the process of Hollywood and big capital. But okay, I began to see how Hollywood was the kind of one of the Trojan horses. It's a Trojan horse left behind when America left on July 4th, 1946. Do you know that I was celebrating July 4th as our Independence Day until I was 21? The Philippines thought of it as our Independence Day until in 1963, President Macapagal said, hey, we won our independence long before that. We won our independence against the Spanish on June 12, 1898. And since then we changed it. And I think that has created a lot of introspection also, which is part of the decolonization process. Which brought me to a description to my mother, and I said, you know, Ma, what I'm dealing with in Perfume Nightmares, you know this song, killing us softly with their song. I mean, we Filipinos are very good. We have a world reputation for being great at karaoke because we can really come in with those Western pop hits and sing with real gusto. Maybe that is part of the benevolent assimilation process, that whether it's movies or karaoke got us into the picture. Now, okay, let me jump to another bookend. Perfume Nightmare was my debut film, which I did in 1977. And the last film that Midori described is, it's called Balikbaya Number One. It's about the first circumnavigation of the globe in 1521, which we are now celebrating the 500th year. Wow, the Spanish came, they discovered the Philippines. Wow, lucky us. I don't know, okay, I've started to reframe things from what I learned from our history books. Okay, my film sort of ends with the Battle of Mactan, which is where Magellan gets beaten by Lapu-Lapu, our chieftain of a small village. And that battle is described by Antonio Pigafetta, the chronicler of that voyage, that more as a typical battle, and he was counting how many Spanish warriors there were and how many 1,500 villagers, savages, attacked our small group of 60 people. Anyway, of course, it was the POV of the invaders. So for them, Lapu-Lapu was the villain and Magellan was the hero of that battle, although he died. But I would like to reframe that battle as, maybe Lapu-Lapu was doing a big cultural struggle. He was trying to preserve a lifestyle, not just winning another plume of a victory, but it was saying, hey, our culture is our way of being. It's our ways of knowing. But why are you coming? And maybe now looking back with hindsight, they started with guns, but in the longer run, it was killing us softly with the alphabet, with our fashions. We stopped wearing our G-strings, although I still like to do that because it's a part of my statement. Hey, why are we giving up everything? Why do we have to dress like them so that to be in? Now, the Americans brought in benevolent assimilation as a policy when they brought in 300 public school teachers on a boat called the USS Thomas. That's why we call them the Thomasites. And they trained our public school teachers. And in a way, this is very different from the other, cultural suppression can come in like the violent ways, like the Spaniards were capturing our babaylans, our shaman women, and feeding them to the crocodiles, as if that would end our spiritual connections with our deities. But then the Americans were smarter and said, hey, let's stop believing that a good Indian is a dead Indian. Let's try to assimilate them and get them to study our ABCs and watch our movies. Then they're easier to govern. So this killing us softly with a song is a kind of strategy that I guess also became evident to me after this period when we were starting to look at our independence, and the Cold War was raging at that time. So let me now, I think, to the question of Midori, can I show a one minute clip? Just to end this with a visual. So we're going to see a little bit of the end of the trip. Enrique, the slave, has been in the last will of testament, becomes a free man on the death of his master. And so what does happen to him at the end of that battle? So let's go and share this. And go.
That they may have to fight a physical war. On board the ship, one of the sailors panics and fires a cannon. And Lapu-Lapu has no choice. Back Enrique and rejoices, not necessarily at the first circumnavigation of the globe, but just at the return of a lost son. And so Enrique returned to be able to tell future generations about the first circumnavigation of the globe.
So that's how this world traveler who accidentally becomes the first circumnavigator of the globe, beating his master to the title, comes home. I don't know if you guys recognize that was me 40 years ago playing the slave as part of my strategy to be able to tell this story. But I think, you know, that's the last thing. I just realized that ending I chose was really learning after that killing us softly, traveling around the world, he had learned again to dance his own dance, sing his own song, going back to his culture and finding its strength. That's my decolonization process. And I think it might be relevant to our conference today. Thank you, Midori, for inviting me.
So first, I think we'd like to invite our panelists for the questions.
So Reiko's question is to Lesley. It's about, there are two parts. So how much of geopolitical intention was held by the artists themselves and the exhibition curators? For the exhibition in the US.
Thank you, Reiko, for the question, Dr. Tomy. I think in a way, this exhibition in the US was conceived in part due to the physical inaccessibility of the mainland. And that's why, in a way, through that, it became a marker for artistic and ideological difference between the mainland side and the Taiwanese side. So in a way, as I mentioned, the American culture was quite prevalent. Artistic culture was readily available to artists in Taiwan. So they knew that abstraction was the lingua franca of the world at the time. And so for them, to make their work more visible in the world, more readable to the world. They know that abstraction is the style that they should adapt. But at the same time, they did look back to their own culture, thinking that landscape painting traditionally was never really about depicting the mountains. It's really about the mind. So in a way, they found that whole idea of landscape painting to be abstract itself. So in a way, it's a match under this kind of a condition and circumstance. From the curator's side, he himself was a expert in Yuan Dynasty painting, landscape painting. So naturally, that's something he was looking for, perhaps in the more contemporary works. But I think the part of the construct of this exhibition that it sought, he sought funding from the Rockefeller Fund, the JDR Third Fund. The fund itself was the organization that facilitates cultural diplomacy and cultural exchange under that kind of American foreign policy. So I think at the time, what was available to the curator was this, and that's the active organization that's supporting exhibitions of styles of works that may have similarities or affinities to what's hip or what's accepted in the US. But interestingly, when this exhibition was touring the US in the 60s, sort of the heyday of abstract expressionists is already past. Hard edge paintings, opt art, and conceptual art has already come on the scene. So that's also another reason that contributed to that, to may perhaps not be so welcomed or so attract become, then there wasn't a new attraction in town. So I think the intention was what Reiko was asking is perhaps incipient in the whole situation and circumstance. And my paper was trying to argue how these background forces created this kind of circumstance for this kind of particular style of art to emerge.
So we have a question from John von Qualis. In 1968, when the American or diasporic Chinese critics wrote about the Chinese landscape painting exhibition, did they mention the Cultural Revolution was going on in mainland China at the time? If so, how did it relate this to the paintings on exhibition?
Thank you for that question. I actually opened my paper sort of with that comparison, as 1966 was the start of Cultural Revolution on the other side of the Taiwan Strait. No, from the reviews that I have read, there wasn't sort of explicit mentioning of that. Most of the critics or newspaper reporters were just talking about how this is the artistic style that's emerging from the new China. So it wasn't, as far as I know, to my knowledge, it wasn't so, that kind of contrast wasn't highlighted, but in my paper, I put that as part of the background. Thank you.
Oh, we will come to the next question in the Q&A from Narisa Bowles. It's for Kidlat. So it's about so it says you were making films during Marcos' time, and your last film, Balik Bayan, was the post-Marcos era. As an artist during the Cold War and the post-Cold War era, do you think dictators in power influence your work? Balik Bayan as a term is used by various Philippines residents.
You know, when martial law was imposed, I was in Germany at that time. So in a way, I was watching what was happening from a distance. I was very aware that Marcos was a vital pawn in the Vietnam War. And the city where I come from, like Hiroshi was talking about, the US base was a very central thing in our town. And it was, but it was not the aggressive base. It was Clark Field and Subic were air bases where jet planes were flying and bringing combat troops there. John Hay Air Base in Baguio was a rest and recreation base. So all these battle-weary soldiers would come up to Baguio, and I could see that this was one of the clever tools that Mr. Marcos used to be able to keep American support for his dictatorship. When I came back in 1979, I was doing my films. Since my films were not directly talking about martial law, but had, I don't know if an anti-colonial theme might have some indirect bearing on sitting dictators, but I was able to finish my films, although my films were never shown publicly. I never had a big audience. So I was not a dangerous, and Indy is not a dangerous filmmaker because he doesn't have big movie stars, big box office potential, and his messages may not be absorbed by the big public and revolt against the dictator. So I believe your question is in the context of how, as an artist, I continue to operate under that regime. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think my themes have somehow survived the topicality of martial law and the dictator. I mean, not that my works are anything of highly political value, but at least in terms of looking at the colonial process. You know, whenever I make a film, I think half of my enemies are probably the most liberal people too, because I'm not using a film language that they're familiar with. Most people are still brainwashed by the Hollywood way of telling stories. And if you try to tell your anti-colonial story in your own way, you might leave a few more confused people saying, hey, what's this guy up to? And so I didn't do it the popular way, I mean, I'm saying, but I think I have been acknowledged lately that my films may have relevance to nationalist movements, anti-colonial movements, not necessarily with a clenched fist, but in a humorous way. I hope that answers the question.
Okay, so there are other questions for Kidlat as well. And I just want to briefly mention, there's a message from Daryl Davis that says, it's wonderful to see you, Kidlat, after many decades. You remain so inclusive, incisive, and provocative. So I hope you received that message. And another question for Kidlat from Kifi Ma. Thank you for your insight on killing US softly and the importance of decolonizing the self. My question is, how can we teach others to see how certain practices are killing us softly, and how can we expand ways to decolonize ourselves and others?
In a way, that is the hardest enemy. I mean, I guess if I would do a clenched fist way, I would just dynamite all the television towers and maybe the cineplexes and try to snuff out those colonizing visuals, killing us softly. But I've just come to accept that anyway, my films themselves may not necessarily have the broad audiences that need to be colonized. But maybe I've started a small process, because there are not of indie filmmakers now who can make films with a more palatable language, more popular language, and who can deal with this and spread the word. I can, in my small way, okay, I have a reputation for wearing my G-string, my loincloth, to ambassadors' cocktail parties or to award-winning sessions. And it's a small way I can make a statement that, why are we ashamed? Why do we believe their narrative that it's shameful to be to do the old rituals or to wear our old costumes? Why do we have to be cool and dance to Michael Jackson and wear jeans to be in, but that in is their in, and this is not always necessarily meaning it's also our being in. So in this way, my cultural battles center on this, and I leave it to the next generation of indie filmmakers to have a clearer, more palatable message for the broader audiences.
Thank you so much. Also, there's a question from Russell Lung, which I think we can paraphrase a little bit into how we may develop artistic strategies to resist China dominance in Southeast Asian states. I think this is a very tough question, but I also wonder if we have sufficient context to address this question today. So I'd like to ask if any of the panelists would like to respond to that. So actually we have another artist writing about art and the Cold War in Southeast Asia, who is also a Malaysian-born Taipei-based artist. And in her film installation, she discusses extensively about the migration, the issue of migration and Chinese identities in Malaysia and Southeast Asia. So if you're interested in that issue, maybe you can check out her chapter and her videos. Some of them are online. So I'd like to come to Nerissa's question for Hiroshi. So thank you for your fascinating trailer. Could you talk about your artistic decision to show these intimate photographs at this time of Black Lives Matters and the Me Too era? The photographs are beautiful and also problematic, and I would like to hear why you choose to entitle your film There Was Love.
Yeah, yes, actually, There Was Love is just a quote from the movie, and the title of the movie is From Okinawa with Love. And From Okinawa with Love is not only about the photographs, but also her experience of working at a bar, living as an Okinawan, having a complex, troubled identity as an Okinawan growing up. In the island occupied by the U.S. and the presence of U.S. military. I understand that the picture that I showed, I just wanted to show the rawness that she was talking about through that picture, but the book Akabana is not only just a naked picture of women and men, specifically of Black men, but also all kinds of life in general of these people who are hanging out at the time. And then also why I think, because I actually presented this little bit of a trailer to a workshop in New York, and in some ways the participants of the workshop all became very hysteric when they saw the Black male body. And they asked me, how dare you present a Black male body? How dare, what right do you have to represent Black body? And it's a very interesting question. First of all, the images of a Black male in her photographs are, first of all, beautiful. And then also it's a celebration of youth, sexuality, connection between Okinawan women and African-American American soldiers. And then also these African-American soldiers are part of the colonizers. And then these women that she took the pictures and that are working at a bar. And then also Mao Ishikawa herself was were barmaid. So there's this like complex power relationship. And the photograph in some ways not only talks about the beauty and beauty of black male body, as well as the Okinawan women's body, but also this power play. And it's not so simple, and it's really rich and complex. And I would love you to see the film and see the whole scope of things, because it's not just, it's a lot of contradiction, and it's a lot of beauty, and it's life as it is.
Thank you very much, Hiroshi. And the last one is a comment rather than a question, is to thank Roger's close reading of the photographs and the fantasy paintings. Yes, indeed, I think as editors, we enjoyed reading that chapters a lot. Since we are approaching the end of today's event, if there's no pressing questions, I'd like to wrap up. Midori, would you like to say something to close the event, or does any of the panelists like to add anything?
Maybe have questions to each other?
I'd like to react to just what Hiroshi said, no? That I think we artists, whether we're motivated by the beauty of bodies or some aesthetic or environmental energies within us, there will always be people who will frame our work in terms of political correctness. And there will always be people who will try to question our motives. And quite often I sometimes learn about political framings in my film when I read it from the critics. And it may not have always been a conscious artistic input to make it, a forceful political statement or what. So I think more people have to understand the artistic process, which is we are reacting to, maybe sometimes to mind inputs, but sometimes we're just reacting to what is there. And if the black body merged with also an acute Asian body creates a new, a new appreciation for that closeness, and it evokes stories of love. I think we should leave it there than always trying to contextualize it with new political slogans.
So I kind of like saw that there's a resentment for being categorized or being fit into something. Is that correct?
You're asking me?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I'm sometimes afraid when people start categorizing things in very either academic terms or in very very nuances but make it a thing that slices somebody out from their context. And maybe I have been very sensitive about I'm a third cinema director. Or if people say, hey, Kidlat, you're wearing a G-string. Are you an exhibitionist? I mean, you can frame anything and so that you can, just to debunk anything. I think we have to be aware of that. And maybe sometimes we just have to take the artistic value. And if it has a political connotation, it's a bonus. Although, of course, there are also very strong works that are driven by a strong political ideology and also become aesthetic wonders. No? So I feel that sometimes there are too much reading in, and maybe that's not my problem. I hope.
Thank you. So thank you very much, everyone. It just went so quickly and we've been on screen for 1 hour and 44 minutes. So I think we will need to close.
Yeah, so before we conclude, I just wanna congratulate Professor Yamamura and Professor Lee on their new book, along with all the rest of the contributors who are able to join us today for today's discussion. The link to purchase their book is available on our website, the page that you went to register for this talk. Please use the discount code FLR40 to get a discount on the book. Good summer reading. Learn more about their chapters and everybody else who couldn't join us today. For any attendees seeking information on Asian American history and anti-racism resources for your classroom or community, the Institute has a list of available resources on our website under publications, CUNY Forum, in the resources section of Corona Conversations. Enjoy the rest of your summer, stay healthy, get vaccinated, and be an upstander if you see a fellow person in need. See you soon at our other upcoming events, and check out the video later on this afternoon or tomorrow morning, wherever you are. Have a good day, everybody.
Thank you.